Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service.
Beginning of understanding comes with fear of the Lord. Many of us have heard these words. Many have been taught that God is something to be feared. Scary, terrifying. And while God is God, some of those teachings have scarred us, many of us. To who is God? What is God really like? Is it two different contradictory statements, to fear God and to love God? Some of us are confused. If you've ever had these kind of questions, stay tuned to explore what it means to fear and love God that we find in Christ. Join us this morning.
Better is one day
Will you please join with me in the call to worship found in your bulletins? God of love, cast out our fears, our distrust, and our anger. Help us to be more loving. God, we love you. Help us to love one another in ways that reflect your love of us. In Christ, who is not the messenger, but the message of your love, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite you to join in singing the first two verses of Child of Blessing, Child of Promise, number 677. The Barabee family and godparents to please come and join me up here on the chancel. Twin brothers today being baptized 5 minutes apart for Mr. Samuel, Mr. Gabriel. And we rejoice with them and their families on the day of their baptism. Let us gather at the water in the words of the prophet. Reminds us to come to the water, come any who are thirsty, come for the mighty acts of God are known to us in water. And what we are saying as we approach the water of baptism is this shared life and community together, this journey we take in faith, both in teaching and modeling the Christian faith for Samuel and Gabriel, and their parents also modeling it and their godparents modeling it for them. But also in learning to see God through their eyes as well. It's a two-way street. We will see through the eyes and words of infants and children, Jesus tells us, the very kingdom of God. It is at water that we are reminded of our story with God, the water over which creation, God the Father, brings the worlds into being, the Word of God speaks them into being, and the Holy Spirit hovers above the waters of creation. Waters that divides so that slaves may walk into freedom and to promise. Water which cleanses, which renews, and water which Jesus himself is baptized and bows and kneels at his disciples' feet, washing their feet in ordinary acts of extraordinary love, saying, "If you would be my disciples, you must love one another and be willing to bow down in servanthood. For greatness is measured in how we serve as disciples in love." Baptism is a sacrament in which we are united to Christ and to God in ways of Christ's reconciling ministry of grace and beauty. It's not that God doesn't know and love Samuel and Gabriel before they are born. God does. But at baptism in this sacrament, we recognize God's continual and active presence in their lives, a love that never abandons them. And as God's people here, we make a radical statement by saying that we promise to the best of our God-given human abilities in our lives, flawed as they may be at times, that we will try to mirror God's love for these boys in how we are interactive with them and with each other. That is not something said flippantly or lightly. It is something that takes a lot of practice to live out. So we come to these waters of baptism, recognizing that the love and forgiveness of Christ is not only for us and our household, but also for our children, and that God's love for Gabriel and Samuel will be proclaimed here, and that that promise of God's love will never be revoked by God. And so I'll ask you each some questions of faith and baptism. Do you desire to have these, your boys, baptized into the Christian faith, to seek to teach them about God's love for them and how they can be loving as disciples into the world, to see God's presence both in the creation around them and in others, even those that we might struggle to get along with, perhaps especially so? If this is your desire this day, as parents and as godparents, will you say, we will with the help of God? And in taking Jesus as your own example in your daily lives, will you seek also to teach them the difference between right and wrong, to stand against forms of oppression and evil in the world, to be voice to those who do not have one, any, to stand with the marginalized and the downtrodden as our Lord and Savior did, and to respond in great love to the world's greatest pains and needs? If this is the discipleship you seek to model, will you respond, we will. And we also seek to teach them, but also to learn from them, and guiding them to see God present in community, that we grow together in this Christian faith, and we share together, not just here in this church, your church home, but also in the wider body of Christ, and in the world, in various forms, as God appears in their lives. If this is your desire this day, will you please respond, we will with the help of God.
We will.
And lastly, as parents, you have the great joy and sometimes trials of boys getting sick or a late night of crying, watching them through their first steps, first days at school, first words, and all the adventures of life and challenges as they continue to grow old and into the young men of faith they will one day be. And as godparents, you also have the gift and blessing to share these adventures with them. And I would encourage you in their questions, their doubts about God, about life, about death, to create spaces that are safe for them, to engage you, to ask questions as they grow older, and to know that they have a person in whom they can confide in, who are role models to them, and encourage them in this growth, in this life journey with God. We ask God's blessing to you, and as you're about to receive this journey with them, your pledge and support to follow as best as you are able to reveal God's love to each of these boys as they grow older, both together and as twins, as the individuals that they also are. At this time, I'd like to invite the congregation to please rise with me as we recognize that discipleship is a journey we take together, and it takes many hands, not just those of parents and godparents, but of church family and grandparents and cousins and aunts and uncles and friends. So I invite you to join with me in stating this baptismal promise of support and of faith, hope, and love for these boys. Will you join with me? Gabriel and Samuel, we thank God for you in the love of Christ. As your church family, we will do our best to walk with you as you grow in your journey with God as disciples. We will seek to live out the faith we profess with you, to learn from your faith and life, As you each grow in Christ, we give thanks to God, rejoicing in the Holy Spirit, that as sisters and brothers in Christ, we share this journey with you. Amen. Please be seated. This is the water of baptism, the water which reminds us of who we are and whose we are, born of body and water and of spirit in Christ Jesus our Lord. God, as we meet you at this water, bless both Samuel and Gabriel and their shared life with you. Be with them always in your love and guidance and discernment and wisdom as they grow in faith, loved by you, one of a kind, with a love that is irrevocable. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, who's first here? What is the full name of this child? Samuel Joseph Barabay. I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of God's Holy Spirit, loved by God, anointed by God, always cared for by God. And what is the full name of this child? Gabriel Robert Barabay. Both beautiful biblical names. Gabriel Robert Barabay, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of God's Holy Spirit. Loved by God, one of a kind, both today and all the days of your life and eternal, made in God's image. Amen. I'd like to invite Meg Bollinger to come forward on behalf of Congregational Care to bring you the boys' baptismal certificates and two roses in honor of their beautiful lives before God in this faith community. I'm going to ask, let us pray together. God, for Samuel, for Gabriel, for their families, and for a life journey shared in faith and in hope and love, bless them. And thank you for blessing us by having them in our lives in this community of faith, marked by your love, sealed with your grace, for forgiveness and joy found in the depths of who you are and who we are in you. We pray these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to please join with us in singing the last two verses of Child of Joy, Child of Blessing, Child of Promise. Thank you.
Good morning. This week's scripture reading is from the 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12, and 6b through 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not know God, whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. God has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers and sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God, who they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also.
Even if I ran away, your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side. Your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. rather for my good. You made all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in.
Will you please join with me in a word of prayer? God, there is much that would seek to make us afraid. Shooters, like those we heard about this morning in Orlando, Florida. Prejudices. In an ever-growing public sphere, widening the gap between those who are different from ourselves, different skin color, different ethnicity, different faiths. There is much that makes us afraid. Sometimes even the very institutions that hold your name spouse fear and hatreds. Break through the ugliness of fear. Cast it out. Do not let it distort the truth of perfect love as an arisen Lord who has entered our messiness and our violence in the very depths of our prejudices against one another, to help us to see a different way, to be a different way, and to find grace that is not very present in our world. In the name of the one whom the Epistle of 1 John speaks of as being love in its very essence, God, we pray. Amen. What are you afraid of? Spiders? Clowns? Snakes? Why did it have to be snakes? Shooters? The growing violence in our country? Being alone? Dying? There's a lot of things that make us afraid. And I had a young woman come into my office within the last several months, and her first question to me was, how or can you help me see God differently? You see, my whole life, my parents have told me I've been a mistake. I was a mistake. I was even born, that they were embarrassed by who I am. that it would have been better had I not been born. And then they took me to a church when I was a young girl, almost my entire life growing up, and the pastor there told me all the ways that the things I was doing in my life weren't adding up. How they were sinful, how that I was unworthy, how I was guilty, how I'd spend eternity in fiery anguish. And I was terrified of God. I couldn't even pray. I was scared to go to church. And I wonder today how many people, because I know she's not alone, have grown up. Maybe it was a nun or a priest who'd wrap you on the knuckles in Catholic grade school, or a preacher or pastor, aka and Footloose, Reverend Shaw Moore, and no dancing, no fun of any kind. Or it was as an article that I stumbled across in looking at this sermon called Unfollow from the New Yorker magazine, May 2015, where they were doing an interview, a nearly 40-page interview with Megan Roper Phelps, granddaughter of the infamous pastor and founder of Westboro Baptist Church, the now deceased Fred Phelps. And she talked about how in her church she had grown up indoctrinated that the wrath of God was kindled and ready to burn against a nation that was lax in its morality. Fred Phelps had been a great civil rights preacher in his day, and then had gotten increasingly to a place where his preaching turned heavily fire and brimstone judgmental, particularly against the homosexuality community. And they would picket, as many of you may know, the memorials of Marines and Navy personnel, Army personnel who had been killed in Afghanistan or Iraq. Thank God for dead soldiers. She would tweet things online for AIDS Awareness Day. Thank God for AIDS. You are going to get much, much worse eternally. And I thought, how can this be that we're reading the same Bible, the same canon? Are there passages about fearing the Lord? Absolutely. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord begins all understanding and knowledge. There are over 400 passages in the Bible that speak to fear, but most of those Hebrew sayings, and it's also in the Greek in the New Testament, speak to reverence, to awe, to being inspired by the presence of God, a deep respect, knowing that God is God and we are creatures. What happens to a young woman when she comes to a church hoping to see God who would deem something in her life worthy, some outlet to God, with churches who have told her whole life that she has no place, no value, that everything about her life is abhorrent to God? Where does a person go after that? Those are soul wounds and scars. You mean the maker of all this hates me? You see, there's been many people who've been told that for a lifetime. And yet when you look in the Gospels, you see Jesus stopping the stoning of a woman caught red-handed in adultery. Wait! If any of you who are so eager to cast judgment on this woman are without sin, be my guest. Throw your rocks. The one who walks up to the tree with Zacchaeus and says to this scoundrel who swindled just about everybody and their neighbor and their mother in the town, this rotten scumbag who skims off the top with deep pockets, Zacchaeus, today I'm going to dine in your home, an act of friendship. And the people say, what? The same one who hugs lepers, who dares to touch the blind, and the disciples around him, the good church folks, say, who was it that sinned that made this man blind? And Jesus said, nobody. But that you would see the glory and see God through his blindness. How is it that so many grow up with a God of deep fear, of terror,
and a Christ who comes and walks alongside the very people that many of those churches say have no place, are going to the deepest depths of Hades. And Jesus breaks bread with those very people. Now, I'm not saying that Jesus was okay, everything goes, go ahead and do whatever you want, because Jesus says, go and sin no more. But it is as if the Son of the living God, whom John, 1 John speaks of, comes into our messes, our brokenness, our places of message where we've heard all our life we have no worth, we've done terrible things, and Jesus says it doesn't have to be that way. And shows them a different way, shows them a God of love. You see, there's two different paths to God that I see happening, particularly with Megan Phelps' church. One that is fear-mongering. It's driven by fear. These tracks, this is where you're going to be, smoking or non-smoking, what's your preference? And the baseline of that theology, let's be clear, the baseline of that theology is have relationship with God to avoid the flames of hell. Your fear of avoiding God's punishment is what drives you into relationship with God. Now, maybe some people need that. Maybe that's a scared straight tactic, you know? Show the worst and scare you straight. Maybe that works for some people. Apparently so, because there's a lot of them. But in today's text and throughout the Gospels, in today's text particularly in 1 John 4, 26 times in 15 verses, God is love. If you're going to love God, you have to love each other. You can't hate your brother, sister, and love God. And the perfect love of God, there is no fear. Love casts out fear. What changed Megan Roper Phelps was she was on Facebook, she was on Twitter, and she would tweet and post these terrible things, these very hateful and judgmental things, and then suddenly something happened. The death of actress Bridget Murphy, Clueless and some other films, whom Megan really liked as an actress and really enjoyed her movies. And when the news of her death came out in the compound of Westboro Baptist Church, her church members and family were shouting with joy of thanksgiving at her death, high-fiving each other and rejoicing in the death of another sinner in God's wrath. And Megan looked at around the room and then began going to her social media and seeing this supposedly hell-bound heathen world outside of Westboro Baptist, mourning, showing sympathy and compassion for this young woman who had died tragically young. And she could not equate the two. How is it that these people who we have said to have no place in the kingdom of God seem to reflect God in a way that my family is not? And something shifted in her from fear and hatred and wrath to seeing the incarnate Christ in ways she had not, in places she least expected, and to believing that she had to leave that church and even her family for a God whose love was bigger than the narrow circle that they had drawn around themselves. Now, the example doesn't have to be as extreme as Westboro Baptist. You see, I think each of us struggles in some way and would be wise to hear the words of John in the epistle writing, that God is love. And how do we know love? Not randomly. No, but because this God of love chooses to enter into our very violence, our very rejection, the places where we humiliate and bully each other, where we gossip and backstab each other, where we say horrible things about one another in judgment. It's right in those places that God says, now hang on. That one, this one that you are speaking to that you have wounded, those are my children whom I love too. This comes at a price. My love in the face of your worst. That's the beginning of the kind of love that God has. In a day when I wake up to a mass shooting at Pulse Bar, 2 days after a first shooting in Orlando, same community, it is easy to become afraid, is it not? It is easy to think this world is a mess. And in many ways it is. But it is exactly the place where God loves, calls us and says, do not be afraid. I am a big God. And I'm well aware of human violence and pain. After all, it was done to me. But if you're really going to be my disciples, you must be willing to meet that fear with amazing love. There are two people, a Jewish Orthodox rabbi and an atheist, who were tweeting Megan Roper Phelps all along, despite her hateful diatribe against them and their groups, constantly and consistently inviting her to see God in a different way, even the atheist, that God was bigger than her hate, and that perhaps God loved even them whom she could not, and challenging her to think beyond her narrow walls of what it was to be a Christian. Today, rather than cast stones at Westboro, I would invite us and challenge us, who is it in your life and in mine? Then when I say, who is it that you have trouble loving, you think of immediately. Because all of us have, maybe our list is a little longer than we'd like to admit. And this day, before you leave this place, think about this thought. That Jesus' love is just as strong for that person as it is for you. The workers spent all day in the vineyard agreeing to their wages, and all of a sudden the owner said to a few people waiting around, mulling about all day, the last 10 minutes before the clock, hey, come out to my fields. You know this parable. And he paid them the same amount as the people who had been working all day. And they said, that's not fair. God says, who are you to question who I give mercy to? And do you really understand my kind of love? Think about it before you walk out of here and how you might be more loving to that one as Christ has been loving to you. That's the love of the cross that casts out fear and helps us to see a different world. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite you to turn to page 5. Of your bulletins to see that there are several families that we have continued to be praying for, but I'd like to ask specific prayers for our custodian, Carl Lorak, who's here every day. His sister, Judy, has been in a coma for the last week. She is not responsive, and their family will be making some tough decisions tomorrow. I'd ask you to please keep Carl and his wife and their family in your prayers. And also those other families here on this list and many others who are not listed. Not just today in service, but as you go through, wait, take this with you and pray for them throughout your days. Let us pray. God, in the blessing of our life together, in its joys and beauty that we see in each other, that we may experience tonight in concerts in the park or in worship on many Sunday mornings. But we also experience pain together and sadness. And it is in those places that we also ask you to guide us, to lift us, and to help us hold each other when we have not the strength to walk on our own. We pray your blessing upon those we've named, upon our mission trippers we're about to receive, and their leaders, upon these twin boys on their baptism day, and the joy and wonder of seeing you through their eyes and their parents. May your love surround this place, and may it change us as we go forth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite our high school youth forward and their leaders. As I mentioned, the high school youth are leaving on Father's Day next Sunday to head down to Tennessee. Come on up here, gang. 9:30 is early for some of them. This is a part of our crew, not the whole crew. That's okay. That's okay. We've got two. And they are about to embark on a great journey down to Appalachia, as you saw in the video. And we'd like to pray for them. And as you see some of them up here, again, a reminder to please take one of these. And if you're not able to take one, just write the name of one of these people down and be praying for them throughout the week as they give us updates. Let us join in prayer. And let us take a hand at each of the one next to you. God, for these young adults and for their leaders, for the way that they will be ambassadors of this church, First Congregational United Church of Christ, wherever their feet take them and their voices are heard. And though they go to be a blessing to others who may have had difficult fortunes, and challenges in poverty, we also know that they will be blessed in surprising ways by those in whom they may least expect it, but who will see, they will see you reflected and may have much to learn from our brothers and sisters who they serve. Bring them safety, guide them and bless them, and carry them in love as they carry your love and message out. We pray these things in Jesus' name, that they grow together with one another and you. Amen. Let's give them a round of our support.
You're going to do great. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. Roger. Go ahead and sit down, guys.
Our teens and their leaders will be offering themselves in service. Guided Path and Jim and others will be offering their voice and song this evening. There are many different ways we offer our gifts and talents and our time to make this the faith community is. I invite us to consider how we offer Christ's love here and beyond these walls as we give our morning offering this morning. The ushers, please come forward.
Thank you.
God bless these gifts, not only in the plates, but in the pews and in the chairs, those who stand this day as instruments of your peace, your hope, and your love. May you bless our hands, our bodies, our mouths, and minds to be ambassadors for you, whether in Tennessee or South Africa or on the East Coast. And may you guide us in the love of Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. I invite you to join us in singing our closing song, Everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God.
wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not.
Visiting with us for the first time, one of our closing traditions is to join hands with those next to us, symbolize that we are not on this journey alone, but we take it together in faith. What a novelty it would be if the world knew Christians first, not from their judgments or intolerance or hatreds, but by the depth of their love, by their peacemaking in the face of great violence, by their standing with the poor and marginalized in truth and injustice. Now that would be a body of Christ to which people would flock to. That depends on us. May the message of God's love live in you through Christ our risen Lord. Go in peace. Amen.
Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Please, we hope to see you this evening at 6:30 in the park right behind the church for our 150th anniversary celebration concert. Please stick around and sing and dance with us to I Will Bless the Lord at All Times.
The Lord at all.
a great story.